Okay, so Rick, I did want to talk about one thing in particular that I actually find very interesting. You know, the science continues to come out on this stuff, and that's game meat. So obviously,
I'm hungry.
Obviously, at CRPA, we are consistently promoting hunting. What kind of comes along with hunting, at least within the community, is sharing. You know, you take down a big animal. That big animal has a lot of meat on it. That's why we tend to go hunting in groups some of the time. And sharing that meat can have other benefits. And not only that, as a community, if we wanted to promote harvesting wild, wild meat like that, it can have benefits for other communities throughout the state as well.
Yeah, you know, you bring up an interesting point. One of the things I want to kind of look at is how many people come to me all the time and they're like, oh, that's nice you hunt, Rick, but I don't believe in hunting. I don't believe anything comes from it. And I get it. Like, you know, to choose to go out and procure holistic, natural meat and bring it back, I think is a challenge for a lot of people because we're so far removed from our food sources. One of the areas I think that hunters are in line with today's foodies and today's people are looking for a better holistic way of living because we actually are in touch with where our food comes from in a very intimate way, whereas a lot of people are used to going to the grocery store and just picking something and really have no idea of what it takes to get that product, be it a vegetable, a fruit, or a protein to them, even a plant-based one. And so one of the things I love to talk about with the community is, first and foremost, you know, hunting's not roadkill, Kevin. You may not realize that, but it's not. And it's not something new. You know, I'm working on a cookbook that will come out in the fall with several other hunters and other organizations that CRP will be promoting called True Organic. And one of the things that we talk about in there is, as a person who hunts, I'm also a chef. And so at 4th of July, as you know, because you've been to my house on the 4th, I am known for doing a wild boar over the barbecue, making pulled pork sandwiches, ribs, what have you. And this last 4th of July, I got asked this question and I started to laugh. They're like, well, what'd it take to learn to do pig on a barbecue that's hunted in the field? Cause that's like a brand new thing. Cause we've been using like pigs on farms for like ever. And I to my credit, I didn't laugh. Of course I have a 6-inch gash in my hand from the fingernail I had to put in it, but to keep from laughing. But newsflash, 30,000 years of human history just here in North America was based on backyard barbecue. Did you know that, Kevin?
I didn't.
Yeah, backyard barbecue, because number way to prepare meat was over flame.
Well, I mean, that obviously makes sense. So what it kind of sounds like you're saying is, obviously you have a respect for the process of going out and finding your own food source, and that kind of creates an intimacy with it. Mm-hmm. So then the natural line of progression would also be to, you know, become a good cook, because who wants to go out and harvest their own food and then not know how to cook it when it comes home? But I think what's important about this is not only the fact that, you know, the there's a big difference in the actual meat. The proteins are different. The fat content is different. We're starting to see a lot of that through scientific research nowadays. And then you have the complete other side, which is the sharing. You know, that's sort of what, I mean, what better thing to create a community around than sharing food? You know what I mean? Who doesn't love that? And I think that's a really important role that we've kind of missed out on in recent history.
Yeah, and you bring up a good thing. I mean, there's multiple studies that have been done by reputable medical schools from Harvard to the Mayo Clinic, Scripps, et cetera, that deal with game meat. And one of the things is, you know, portion size. You know, you look at a 3-ounce piece of beef from wherever versus a 3-ounce piece of traditional game meat, which we've been designed to eat for literally millennia. And what you will see is higher protein content, lower fat, way lower cholesterol, In other words, like you think of everything negative with a you know, animal-based protein, it goes away with game meat. And all the positives are way up off of the scale to the point of, depending on the studies that have been out there, but you're seeing at least you have a third better chance of beating cancer while undergoing treatment if you're eating a game meat beef diet rather than, you know, a farm-raised one or another one. And that's significant because I don't know about you, but I don't want to get cancer. And so eating game meat helps to my body defend against that.
Well, and I mean, you have some prominent podcasters out there that are also kind of echoing these points, but autoimmune diseases also. Autoimmune diseases, you know, they can really tear people apart. And there have been a couple of studies that have shown some pretty good evidence that the protein from wild game, you know, helps overcome those diseases.
And I think part of the problem for a lot of people is, you know, they think, well, okay, so if I'm going to go do this, I want to try it out before I go invest in all the time and train and everything to go hunting. Well, you can. You can go to a Sprouts, a Mother's Market, a Whole Foods, whatever. They always have a section that has, you know, elk, deer, wild boar, you know, turkey, other game meats that you can get and try out. And then people are like, okay, so that solved that problem. But then the big one is, how do I cook it? And again, not trying to laugh, because that's a good question, but what we don't realize is if you are one of those people, like, you know, you and I've talked, you've got recipes that go back generations in your family, as do I. You go back to those generations, those recipes weren't calling for, hey, could you give me a pound of Kroger hamburger? It was like, hey, could you give me a pound of meat? And people are like, yeah, same thing. No.
Not the same
thing. It wasn't the same thing. They were saying, go grab a pound of meat off of the deer or the elk or the bison, whatever was hanging in the storage. That's what they were asking for. And, you know, by the time we got to most of our grandmothers were now using the supermarket chain and buying those things. But prior to that, those recipes. So a lot of, quote, modern recipes, A, not modern, and B, were originally for game meat.
Okay, so I guess let's fast forward this a little bit, because and Jacob, if you can pull up the site that we have from the Fish and Wildlife website, we have a little bit of an issue here in California right now, and it's pertaining specifically toward, you know, some of the things that we've criticized our state government for in the past when it comes to preserving our land, and when it comes to preserving our land, that also means preserving the animals that live on it. So go ahead and, Rick, I know that you're pretty heavily invested in this, so why don't you go ahead and explain what this is?
Yeah, so framing this really well, Governor Newsom, by both sides of the political spectrum, has been criticized by the mishandling of this state. And this would be an area, if you look at the California Department of Fish and Wildlife, which is in charge of our wildlife conservation projects here in the state, has tried to do the absolute best job it can to preserve and conserve our resources. But that has not been made easy by this governor and his administration. And as a result, during COVID, we were rampaged by a hemorrhagic fever with rabbits that was spread statewide. It was a national issue, and we had very few resources put out against that disease while fighting the pandemic. Same thing happened with a rotting disease for elk hooves, where they were rotting. Very little was done with that. And we've had a deer hemorrhagic fever that currently is reared its ugly head in the counties of Kern, Napa, and I forget, there was one other county right now that it's active in. I know it's on the website.
Yeah, it looks like it says Nevada County.
Yeah, Nevada County. I knew it was over by Lake Tahoe. And the results of that are, it's devastating the herd. It's killing off the fawns, who are highly susceptible to it. And when I say hemorrhagic fever, a lot of people are like, well, what does that mean? To break it the simplest down, most of us as Americans know what Ebola is in humans. It's the same idea as Ebola, only in deer.
Got it.
I think if our state was honest and the news media said, oh my God, deer have their own version of Ebola, the public would be like, what? And be up in arms in it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, right now it's like, oh, we have deer zombies. Okay. Like, no, not okay.
Okay. And again, we always try to kind of connect things, right? So you know, there's been sort of an information war going on for a long time, a lot of it revolving around speech, a lot of it revolving around general perceptions. So we have a state government that seems to be trying to point our populations away from firearms in general. They're making it more difficult for us to buy firearms. They're making it more difficult for retailers to be open to provide firearms for people. So I can think, you know, kind of a logical conclusion of that is if people aren't buying firearms in California, the hunting culture would probably start to dissipate. I think where that might end up, you know, drawing a parallel to this is conservation efforts in California are primarily created by the hunting community.
Well, yeah, I mean, former Governor Jerry Brown had said a few years back that it has been hunters and fishermen who have done 98% of the conservation work since the 1930s. That's almost 100 years worth. And largely the greatest comebacks of some species to the point of there's more of them today than when we first got here as Europeans that were selling this continent is our legacy. And if you remove those hunters and fishermen from the spectrum here politically, not only are you going to have the mismanagement of those different populations, but Kevin, what a lot of people don't realize is the money generated from that is what pays to keep like between 40% and 50% of the state's parks and lands open to the public. So you remove that and people are like, oh, let's go have a picnic. Let's go for a, oh wait, it's closed. Yeah. Because the money that pays for that to stay open, not there.
So, I mean, you know, that some of that weight ends up sort of residing on CRPA's shoulders. And the way that I think about it is we need to continue and educate people on these facts because they're not exactly given them. But, I mean, let's take this for example. I mean, can you think of a way that an organization like CRPA or any other organization could help amend this problem? Is this something that only the state can do? I mean, how do we fix this?
No, in fact, the state will tell you. Department of Fish and Wildlife will tell you they don't have enough biologists to be everywhere or to be in the right place at the right time often to catch this and do some kind of remedial work. However, they're highly successful. And people are like, well, those two statements don't fit in the same box of truth. By themselves, they don't. But where they do is the connection is all the different stakeholder groups, which are the different conservation groups, such as California Rifle Pistol Association. In this case, one of our closest partners working with deer is California Deer Association, does tireless work constantly on this. We all come together and we all do the parts that we're experts in. I mean, Cal Deer folks are experts at planting and delivering, but we also communicate to our respective members. And so what happens is you got members of this organization, other organizations that are in the field, as this article illustrates, are reporting, oh, I found dead fawns here, or I came across this here. That is the information that allows the wonderful biological team at the Fish and Wildlife Department to be able to target this is the areas that we need the most help in. And then those stakeholder groups, Kevin, go in there and assist with different projects to help create a better environment so we can save those populations and conserve them.
And then I guess the larger scale question, as always, is how do we make sure that we no longer have to deal with the misinformation and the bad legislation when it comes toward conserving our lands? And that always is, we need to be active and we need to be educated and we need to vote. We need to vote based on things like this. You know, I can think of a lot of people, not just in the hunting community, who love Bambi, and they might be just as equally upset hearing that Bambi died from, forgive me if I don't pronounce this correctly, but hemorrhagic disease. Right. So we need to get people to understand that it is the hunting community, it is organizations like ours that are actually investing in making these things better. And it's not always those other, you know, animal rights organizations that are out there doing these things. They want to tell you they're doing them, but we're the ones that are actually investing in it.
Yeah, I think the last thing I would close with is, you know, and something we're missing from our community is making this personable to each person. I mean, obviously, you know, for me, this is highly personable because I hunt and I provide probably 80% of my family's food for now three generations comes from that. A lot of people that don't. And one of the ways you do that is around food. Food is something that humanity has used to bring people together, talk, tell stories, share with each other. And so I've had Jacob include a recipe in this video, Kevin. And it's a lot of fun. It's really easy. It sounds kind of complex when you first see it, but it's not. And for any of you who are like me, I'm a fan of Roy Choi, who's, you know, the famous Kogi taco truck here in LA. I think it's amazing the work he does. And obviously the Michelin people did too, because they've given him a couple stars for that. I haven't got any stars, probably never will, but that's okay. It's not why I do it. But what we have done in this recipe is taken a wonderful Vietnamese meal called shaking beef. This one actually translates the Vietnamese to shaking moose, which is a type of venison. And it basically it's, you know, a taco, a street taco that has lemongrass and ginger and lime and soy sauce that gets put in with the meat. And then you get your veggies on top of it with some sriracha. And so it's fusing game meat with, you know, the Asian culture coming out of Vietnam, along with our own backyard Latin American culture of the street taco, and puts them all together. And you serve those up to your family and friends while you talk about the valuable resource we have here in California and how we don't lose it.
You know, there's lots of positives and negatives in the California legislature, but you know what's always positive? A like on this video. So be sure and like, share, and subscribe. Make sure and hit that little bell so that you can stay tuned for all of our future videos. You can also check us out on Facebook and at crpa.org. If you're looking for up-to-date legislature notes and things that are going on in the courts, the website, and these videos are a great place to find it. So be sure and follow us, and we'll see you next time.